big crowd for these sort of programs. Instead, we will focus on the content so that it will be kept in the YouTube, no, as a document.
Yes,
So
yes.
need not
Yeah.
wait for 100 people to come and then start.
Yeah. No, that too, today is a Sunday and a Valentine's Day, no? We cannot expect much people coming.
So you think that we selected a wrong topic?
Wrong topic, maybe a wrong day.
Okay. But I think we shall start. We shall start.
Yes.
So, namaskaram, a very good evening to all. Continuing with the Tadvidya Sambhasha series, this is the ninth one of the series. We have planned to conduct the Tadvidya Sambhasha on every second Sundays as conversations on Ayurveda, that is, on different topics of Ayurveda, which will shed light on both theoretical and practical aspect of the Shastra, and more importantly, its incorporations and interpretations from the experienced Vaidyas. Before starting the program, a few words about our Gurunathan, on whose remembrance these Jnana Yajnas are being conducted. Padma Bhushanam Vaidya Bhushanam K. Raghavan Tirumalpadu was born on 20th May 1920 and passed away on 21st November 2010. In his 90 years of lifespan, we can identify a multi-talented persona proficient in diverse knowledge streams such as Ayurveda, Sanskrita, Ayurveda, Sanskrita, Jyotisha, Naturopathy, Philosophy, and a lot many more. He was a non-public figure, skilled physician, environmentalist, devoted Gandhian follower, philosopher, expert columnist, and even a politician. His unique way of understanding and explaining the Shastra made him a hub of knowledge, wisdom in his time, bringing out many brilliant scholars. He has written around 40 books in various topics, published articles and delivered authentic discourses on Shastra all throughout his career. He will continue to motivate us forever with his timeless teachings, writings, and through the Shishya Parampara he initiated. Tirumalpadu Foundation is a platform to discuss Shastra in its original context, founded by our Gurunathan. Foundation is exclusively acting with a mission to preserve the originality of the Shastra and to propound it among the scholars and the general public. Here, Tadvidya Sambhashas, conversations on Ayurveda, are designed in such a way that there will be two experts sharing their valuable experiences, and the whole discourse will be moderated by a skilled discussion. Now, I would like to introduce the panelists for the day for Tadvidya Sambhasha on the topic body-mind relation in health and disease. First of all, I introduce Vaidya Parvati Devi Madam. She has completed her BAMS from Vaidiratnam Ayurveda College, Ullur, in 1992, and later secured her master's in psychology from Madras University in 2004. She completed her post-graduation in Manovijnana from VPSV Ayurveda College, Kottakkal, in 2015. She has got more than 22 years of clinical experience, that too in the sector of mental health. She was serving at Government Ayurveda Research Institute of Mental Diseases, Kottakkal, as a medical officer from 1999 to 2010, and is serving as superintendent in the same institution since 2010. She had organized a few seminars in Manasika Roga. She has presented many papers in international and national workshops related with mental health in Ayurveda. She is the state coordinator of unique projects like Manasiga, Jyotirgamaya, Harsham, all related with the different aspects of mental health in the stratas of society, our society. He has also initiated creative ventures like Manaswasthya Gramam, Pradeeksha, Medha, Sudhiram, Susmritam, etc. I cordially invite Vaidya Parvati Devi Madam to the Sambhasha. Welcome, Madam. Now, our next expert for the session is Vaidya Suhas Kumar Shetty. He completed his graduation from Mysore University in the year 1999. Later, he completed his post-graduation in Manasaroga from SDM College of Ayurveda Hassan in 2004. He secured his PhD from Rajiv Gandhi University in 2016. He has an experience of more than 16 years as an Ayurveda practitioner, teacher, and researcher. He is currently serving as professor and head in the Department of Manovijnana Eva Manasaroga and Dean Research and Development at SDM College of Ayurveda and Hospital Hassan. He is also an expert in the field of medical statistics and research methodology. He is an international invited speaker in various conferences and workshops across the globe. He is a member in editorial and review board of many scientific journals, and he has to his credit 3 books and more than 57 scientific articles in various international peer-reviewed journals. He is also a recognized PG and PhD guide at RGHS Bangalore Medical University. He's a recipient of various prestigious academic awards for his works in the field of mental health. I humbly invite Suhas sir to this Sambhasha. Welcome, sir. Now our discussant, Vaidya Sethu Raj KS. He has completed his graduation from Government Ayurveda College, Thiruvananthapuram in the year 2002, obtained his post-graduation on Shalya Tantra in 2010 and secured another post-graduation on Ayurveda Siddhanta in 2014. He started off his career as a tutor in 2006 and is currently working as associate professor in the Department of Samhita and Siddhanta at Government Ayurveda College, Tripunithura. He is known as an ardent follower of Sri Vaidyabhushanam K. Raghavan Thirumalpad and is a part and parcel of Thirumalpad Foundation. His humility, inquisitiveness and dedication for the Shastra on the basis of Guru Thirumalpad sir's lectures make him a unique teacher. I happily welcome Vaidyan Sethu Raj to this Sambhasha. Welcome, Sethu Chetta.
Thank you, Om Prakash. Thank you.
Now, with a prayer to our great Guru Parampara to enlighten our Dharma, I invite our panelists to begin with the session. And I'm handing over the dais to the discussant. Thank you. Namaste.
Thank you, Dr. Om Prakash. Chaturmuga Samarambham, Pagbhadacharya Madhyamam, Asmadacharya Paryantam, Vande Guru Parampara. Offering my respects and prayers at the feet of my preceptors and my Gurunatha, I take over the responsibility in today's conversation to be the discussant here, and I have been entrusted to facilitate the discussion among the panelists. And without taking any time further, I'll give a general structure about the discussion or the conversation we have planned for today. Initially, we shall go through the fundamental aspects of the concept of body and mind as per the recommendations of our Shastra. And that will be given by both of the panelists. And after that, we'll move on to the various aspects of the concept of body-mind construct in the concept of health or swasthya. And after that, we'll go in detail to the role and the relevance or the significance of the construct of this body-mind complex in the pathogenesis, in the process of pathogenesis. And after that, there will be a discussion on the strategies to be developed for the management of these issues. And then we'll go for to some of the general topics related to these psychosomatic disorders or the kind of issues which we are about to deal today. And very we are very lucky enough that we have some of the best experts in their field of Ayurvedic psychiatry or Ayurvedic practice involving both the body and the mind. And initially, at the very onset, I invite Dr. Parvati ma'am to speak out or to come up with her views of the concept of body-mind complex in the understanding of the health as well as in. Thank you, madam.
Very good evening to all. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. Yes,
is it okay? Okay. Let's start. According to Ayurveda, mind and body are not separate entities. It's interconnected. Starting from Ragadiroga, the first sloka of Ashtanga Hridaya means desires lead to diseases. And mind and body shares an inseparable relation throughout one's lifetime. Mind influences bodily physiologies and bodily physiology determines mental states. It's always bidirectional. There is always a homeostasis in this crosstalk, which keeps you healthy. If this homeostasis is disturbed, one becomes ill. This crosstalk has preventive, predictive, and curative aspects. As bodily pathological states negatively influence one's mood, thought, process, and behavior, mental ill health results in incidence of many inflammatory disorders, increases hospital stay, and afflicts the prognosis of diseases. Let's elaborate this and give this give and take mechanism with respect to mind and body. In health, in causation of disease, symptomatology, in treatment, and in preventive aspect. In health, the definition of swastha, I think Dr. Suhas will explain in detail about the description, definition of swastha and all. And I want to move to the causation of disease and the aspect of diseases. Charaka in Vimanasthana describes that Techa Vikara Parasparam Anivartamana Kamadaya Jaradayascha, that is Sharidanam Sharirena Manasana Manasena Sharidanam Manasena. In Ashtanga Hridaya, Hridaya Bodhika Vyakhyana, there's a description of Mana Sharira Yotapa Parasparam Abhivraje Adharadhaya Bhavena Taptajya Khadayoriva, about the relation of mind and body. You can see physiological factors in the etiology of Sharirika Roga and physical factors and dosha involvement in Manasa Roga. Example in Vata Vyadhi, Chinta, Shoka, Krodha, etc. In Pandu, Kama, Chinta, Bhaya, like that. In Jwara, that Vidhi Bhedana, Sharir and Manasa, two types are there. In Kushtam, Sadhu, Ninda, Vadha, Anya, Swaharana, like that. Descriptions are there. To opposite, the physical factors are there in the etiology of Manasa Roga also. That's in Unmada, Viruddha, Dushta, Ashuji, Bhojanani, along with the psychological factors, stress, and Panyavaradha, other factors, this physical factors are there. In Abasmara, Ahita, Ashuji, Bhojana, that is in its etiology, and in Atatva Abhinivesha, Malina, Harasilasi, in almost all mental disorders, you can see some physical factors also. And let's check how it's working, how these psychological factors affect bodily factors. One, by affecting Agni, then Dosha and Dhatu and Ojas. Mainly these are affected by physiological factors. And first we can go through how psychological factors affect Agni. And, this matra matraya abhyavahidam abhyavahrutam pathyam channam na jityate, like that in the case of Agni, the psychological factors affecting Agni, charaka in charaka vimana, chinda, shoka, bhaya, krodha, dukkha, all these are affecting our Agni. The description is there. And in Sushruta also, ichha, abhikhada, bhaya, shoka, hade, andaragnav, like explanation is there. And this is the reason for excessive gastrointestinal conditions. And now we can check how this psychological factors affect Vata, Pitta and Kapha, the doshas. The reason for Vata Vriddhi, then Kama, Shoka, Payadvayu, Krodhat, Pittam, like that the vrutha the reason for vrutti of tridosha has explained, and pitta vartha factors krodha shaukha paya upavasam, these factors are there in the pitta vartha factors. Based on clinical observation, chronic psychological condition lead to pitta vada vrutti. Further leads to ushna ruksha guna vrutti and dhatu paka, depletion of dhatu will occur. Saumya dhatus are affected due to chronic psychological stress. Rasa, shukra, ojas, these dhatus are more affected. And how this psychological factors affect of dhatu. Then kshaya of rasa dhatu results from adichinta, shoka, irshya, ulkanta, etc. And this hrudayasthani rasa kshaya upayati. This is affecting the kshaya of rasa dhatu. And in Charakam Nidanam, Sushruta Sutram, everywhere these descriptions are there. Bhaya shoka dhyana upa shoshito rasa dhatu, like that description is there. So the reason for cardiovascular disease or skin conditions, everywhere it's there by the affliction of rasa dhatu. While describing agrim, Charaka says about shukra dhatu, daurmanasyam garbhadharana, daurmanasyam avrishyanam, saumanasyam garbhadharananam, this type of descriptions are there. And all these are affecting the ojas. You know, ojashiyade kopa chudhyana shokashramadhi, be like that. Essence of all dhatus, the vital energy that rules our immune power, if diminished, ability and frequent diseases, immunity is decreased and the chance of disease is small. And Ayurveda described this about thousands of years ago. And this concept is introduced in modern science only after 1974. That's introduction of a concept of psychoneuroimmunology. Dr. Alfred Adler in 1974 introduced the psychoneuroimmunology, and this describing about the how psychological factors influence immune and endocrine systems. And this neuroimmunology, this description is there in Ayurveda long years ago. And this bhaya, shoka, krodha, all these are affecting agni dushti, vata pitta dushti, rasa dushti, and resulting in reduced ojas or ojo dushti. And in the symptomatology, this related to the etiology, and in symptomatology, there are diseases, different types of diseases that manoadhishtana manasa roga, manoadhishtana sharira roga, shariradhishtana manasa roga, like that. There are descriptions. And in manoadhishtana manasa roga, you can say kama, krodha, lobha, moha. That's the etiology is in the mind, and the symptoms are... symptoms are, or it's affecting in mind also. And the other type are sharira adhishtana manasaroga. The description of these are in nanatmaja vyadhis, in the 80 vada vyadhi and 40 pitta, pitta and 20 kapha rogas. There are many diseases related to psychological origin, or the symptoms are we can observe the symptoms in mind. That's for example, ashabda shravana, auditory hallucination, brahma, vishada, adipralabam, aswapnam, then anavasthita chitatam. All these we can see in the case of nanatmaja vyadhis of vata, and tama in pitta, and tandra and nidradhikya in the context of kabhaja, nanatmaja vyadhi. And for manoadhishtana sharira roga, the shoka jajwara, kama jajwara, krodha jajwara, bhaya jadisara, all this other. And then mental diseases of psychosomatic origin. There are, the etiology comes from mind and body. Like in unmada, avasmara, madha, murcha, sannyasa, in all this. Virudha dushta, shuji, bhojanani, pradarshanam, deva guru dujanam. Both etiologies are there. All these comes in the symptomatology. And in the treatment aspect, we can go through the treatment aspect, the involvement of manas and sharira, then psychosomatic and somatopsychic. Where the involvement only importance is or difference lies only in the extent of involvement. Where it is more, in the mind or body. Then treatment will change according to the involvement only. So, Ashtanga Bhagavata says that tadhasi shuddha dehasya prasadam labhate mana. Then the body purification leads to the purification of mind also. And charaka also hridindriya shirakoshte samshuddhava manadibhi mana prasadam atnadi. And same lakshana are described in Shodhana Samyak Lakshana, Vigadvanmada Lakshana, Dhadu Samyak Lakshana, Swastha Nirvachana. Everything, almost all the symptoms are same in all these contexts. That the prasanna, atma, indriya, mana are the main symptom of all these shodhana and all other contexts. In general disorders also, there should be some psychological process or psychological treatment. It has described. Then in pitta chikilsa, the main main treatment is on mind or the psychological aspect. And in jwara chikilsa also, it is saying that jwara kala smridim chasi haribhir vishay hari. Then the thought of the jwara should be eliminated. Then only we can say that the jwara is the person is recovered from jwara. Otherwise, if one has the sickness feeling or the ill feeling, then also it is also considered in the treatment aspect. And in adravya chikilsa also, almost all the adravya chikilsa are of psychological therapies. In the treatment aspect, we can see that we can do the treatment in the bodily level, at the physical level. So, how physical treatment affect psychological symptoms or psychological issues. That's that all described in this. And in preventive aspect also, then this psychological, how we can improve our health through improving our mental health. There are descriptions of Sadvrata, explanation of codes of conduct under the title Sadvrata, with emphasis on social and preventive personal behavior, as they both affect mental and physical aspect of health. Sadvrata is the code of conduct which helps to gain health and control over mind. Then different types of Sadvrata, Vyavaharika Sadvrata, Samajika, Manasika, Dharmika, Sharika. There are different types of codes of conduct are there in Sadvrata. And then Achara Rasayana, Satyavadinam Akrodham, how we can control our mind and how we can prevent diseases. The description is there in Achara Rasayana. Then Ahitebhyo, the Sattvavajaya Chikilsa also aiming in controlling Ahitebhyo, Arthebhyo, Manonigraha, how to control our mind from desires or Ahita Arthas. Then that is the Ragadi Roga, how to control, we can control this Ragadi Roga. So in all the aspects in the health, in health and diseases, causation, then symptomatology, then treatment, and in preventive aspects, everywhere this mind-body relation, this a strong mind-body relation we can observe. And I think afterwards in the clinical aspect, we can go through that. I am introducing this only, and then I'm concluding with this. Then you can continue with Dr. Suhas, his opinions we can
hear. Thank you, madam. Thank you for the comprehensive yet brief and rapid presentation of these topics recommended to you, sir. Madam, and now we'll move on to Suhas, sir, to seek his views regarding these topics, the concept of body mind construct in the aspect of health as well as ill health, and some of the finer aspects of the basics shall also be discussed. Sir, please.
Agnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurulmitam Ena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha. Bowing at the lotus feet of Padma Bhushana, Vaidya Bhushana, K. Raghavan Tirumalpad, and all the teachers and preceptors of Ayurveda, and the learned scholars of this panelist, and the senior physician Dr. Prasad and my co-panelist, Dr. Parvati Madam, and the moderator and the convener of this program, Dr. Om Prakash and Dr. Swetu Raj, and all the participants of this discussion on Tadvidya Sambhasha, taking a very important concepts of how the body and mind are related to one another and what is their relationship in health and disease. As I think comprehensively and beautifully covered by Dr. Parvati Madam, she has given a very nice overview of the basic understanding, how we can understand this concept of how the body and mind are related to one another at various aspects of health, disease, and especially the pathogenesis and the treatment. To add a few of the important points that she had already emphasized on, and maybe put on a few light on some of the basic concepts of how this body and mind are related at health, beginning with. See, as rightly said by Dr. Parvati, and as we have the various description and the references, that never ever the Ayurveda has said that there is something called as body complex and the mind complex. So it is never two different entities. They are always related to one another, as rightly mentioned, that they share a adhara adheya bhava, as mentioned in Hrudaya Bodhika Tika of Ashtangadya Sutrasthana, first chapter and first loka. And even at various levels, maybe though we call it like when it comes to classification of the doshas or classification of the mental diseases, we always classify it as Sharika dosha and Manasika doshas, or Sharika roga and Manasika rogas. And at the same time, even when it comes to the Adhisthana of the rogas or Adhisthana of the vyadis, also we mentioned that there are two basic Adhisthana of the vyadis, the Sharika vyadis and the Manasika vyadis. But they're not the tight compartmental differentiation between body and mind. Never ever we can differentiate the body and mind. And as rightly emphasized by Parvati Madam, it is the base on the I think there is some disturbances at the background. I kindly request to kindly mute. Thank you.
Clear, sir. Clear.
Yeah. So based on the extent of involvement that we always try to see, which has, because it's all based on the treatment. See, why we need the extent of involvement is for the planning the treatment, like which whether we need to give more emphasis on Devapashraya, Yuktivapashraya, Sattvavajaya. This definitely is based on the extent of involvement. But ultimately, all the three set of treatments are important for both physical disease as well as for the mental disease. And as we find in the first chapter of Charaka Sutrasthana, that the life or the of an individual is a conglomeration of all the components of body, mind, senses, and the soul. So it is like Sharirendriya Sattvatma Sanyoge Dari Jivitam Nityagascha Anubandascha Paryaya Ayuchyate. So it is a combination of the body, mind, senses, and the soul, which makes an individual, which we call it as a life. So here again, there is a discussion why though the sense organs are a part of the body, why it has been again been given emphasis. The reason it is being told in the Tika is that it is just to emphasize its importance. Though the indriyas are also the part of the sharira, but as to give the importance, because they play an important role as their uttamangas, and as they play a major role in the disease or as in the basic life perception of the knowledge. So they have given importance. So that is why the indriyas are also a part of the sharira, but it has been given emphasis. And that's why we find that it is the sharira indriya sattva atma. And when it comes to the adhisthana of the rogas, even though it is in charaka, it is the sharira and indriya manas. But in Shushruta, even Indriya is also the Adhisthana of the Vyadis. So they are the three Adhisthana of the Vyadis. So again, it's based on the whole concepts. So when again, when we talk about what are its relevance, like I think at all level of health, disease manifestation and treatment, I think we always should give importance to this body-mind complex or the body-mind relationship, because each one of them will always influence at the level of the health as well as at the level of diseases. So let's take a few examples at how it can have the influence on the health. See, we always define health in Shushruta Sutrasthana 15th chapter, that samadosha samagnishcha samadhatu malakriya prasanna atmendri manaha swastha ityabhidhiyate. I think this is the most comprehensive definition that we always quote. And we always say that this is just similar to that of the definition quoted by WHO, that health is a complete state of physical, mental, and social well-being, not merely absence of a disease or infirmity. So, but when it comes to probably the assessment, like how we could be assessing that in terms of where we should be include, how we'll be able to assess them, like, so though this definition tells you that it is a normal status of the dosha, dhatu, mala, agni, and the well-being of atma, indriya, and manas. But how a student or how a physician would like to assess them? Because this, in fact, is not the assessment parameter, but it is more of a cause. It is a cause of a health rather than the assessment of health. Because if this all of this are functioning normally, then probably we can judge or adjacent that this person is apparently healthy. But how we are going to assess that, how the doshas are in normal states and how the agni is working functionally. So you need to have some parameters or some lakshanas of which we can take the help of Arogya lakshanas mentioned in Charaka, Shushruta, and also in Kashyapa Samhita. Especially if you go to the Charaka Samhita in Vimanasthana, where he mentions about the karana, karya, karyoni, karyaphala. So in the context of that, he tells that karya is the one when we can assess that there is a rugupashamanam, swaravana yogaha, abhivahare, ahare samyak jarnam, okay? And there is a proper sleep, proper digestion, proper metabolism. A person do not get any unwanted dreams. So his sensory and the intellectual function is said to be normal. And same, we get the Arogya Linga, as mentioned in Kashyapa also, like ananna bilasha buktasya paripaka sukhena cha sushta vinmuta vatatvam. So all this probably will help a physician to understand that, okay, when a person, maybe if you ask, we can ask 4 or 5 questions, like the basic appetite of an individual, basic digestion, metabolism, his bowel movements, his sleep, can help an individual to say he's apparently healthy. But how will we assess the prasanna atma indriya manaha? See, many times the prasanna atma is probably wrongly correlated that it is the normal status of the mind, of the soul or the spirit. So it is not the soul that we are talking here. So it is, as if you look into the Dalhana Tika, the Nibandha Sangraha, of what exactly do you mean by prasanna atma. And here he mentioned that atma iti deha. So here it is the self realization or the spiritual aspects of individual or the self-realization of an individual that he talks about. It is not the soul that we are talking about here. Because as you know, soul is responsible for the chetana. It's a chetana shakti, but it is just an observer and do not play a major role as a participant in the health and diseases. So with the help of indriya and the manas, that it always manifests the health and diseases. And that is why it is not easy to assess the prasannata of the atma. So here atma prasannata refers to how a person is happy with himself, how a person is content with himself. And that is what we get the word as atmagnya. Okay, atmagnya is the word that has been used in the context there. And that is we get the same word, like it is atmagnya karana yogat jnanasya pravartate, as mentioned in Charaka Sharira Sthana. So it is the self-actualization, or like how a person is and how well he define himself as atma, we get as atmadi jnana. Like when we say as a dhi dhairi atmadi vijnanam mano dosha oshadam param. Here atmadi jnana, as mentioned in Charaka Sutra Sthana 11th chapter in Krishnesya Adhyaya, that here Atmadi refers to Atma, Desha, Kula, Kala, Bala and Shakti. If a person realizes his potentials and is maintaining the moral, ethical, physical component based on the place where he's living and where he is staying, the knows his Bala and the Shakti, probably it will help an individual to realize that he is fine. You also get a very good probably explanation for this shloka by Chakrapani. As you know, the Chakrapani also has given the commentary for the Sutra Sthana of the Shushruta Samhita, where he mentioned that here the Atmadi Prasanna refers to that it is the Dukkha Rupa Virahita, that a person is apparently devoid of the diseases and a person is Atmagnaha, he is comfortable with himself. Probably the best way of assessing that is where a person is responsible, and if a person is satisfied with himself or herself, it can say that it is the Prasanna Atma. And the Prasanna Indriya refers to the proper perception of the sense organs, where a person is able to have the normal perception in terms of the Jnanendriya and the Karmendriya. And coming to the Prasannata of the Mana, refers to where a person, it is one of the definition you get is Prasanna Mana Iti Ragadi Virahita. So Ragadi Virahita is like as mentioned in the first chapter of Ashtanga Hridaya, Ragadi Rogan Satatana Shaktan. So, but I think it is not just the absence of the disease, as it is mentioned in the definition itself. It is not just Ragadi Virahita that we are talking about, but if a person, it is more of a Prasannata, like being satisfied. Like if we go to the definition of the mental health, where a person is being comfortable with himself, and if a person is comfortable with the people around him, and he's able to adjust to the changes of life, and if a person is able to adapt to the stresses of life. See, that is why it is not the stress or the problem which is important in life. It is individual's response. How a person responds to the stress is more important. Because sometimes the same set of stress, two different individuals can play different roles. And that is where, again, the role of the sattva come into act. That it is the sattva pariksha or the examination of sattva which differentiates individual, how they respond to different aspects, like in terms of whether it is the pravara sattva, madhyama sattva and avara sattva. And apart from Charaka Vimana, there's also in Shushruta Sutra Sthana 35th chapter, where he mentions that it is the how we'll assess sattva, it is by the vesana abhyudhaya aviklavakaram. Like how an individual responds to the events of life, the happy events, the sad events, and how he is able to get motivated. Like suppose somebody dies in the family, like how a person responds for a given time will always be the important aspects of assessing the individual, how he has to be assessed. So this is what has to be evaluated, that it is the normal status of the physiological functionings, the psychological functionings, the sensory functionings, and the cognitive functionings that we can always talk about whenever we talk about the health. So with this is a very brief outline that we can talk about in terms of how the body and mind are related to one another in the status of health. So in the coming discussion, probably we can take up the pathogenesis and the treatment.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for a brief, comprehensive, yet enlightening discourse on this recommended area. Sir, I would like to have some thoughts being shared by some of the participants here. And one of the questions or one of the questions raised was how one can differentiate between the extent of a sharirika roga and the manasika roga, or is that exactly possible? And we have come to the conclusion that this is not watertight compartments, but however, in real practice, how do we differentiate, discern between the extent of the physical component and the psychic component in a disease?
Yeah, I think this is a very relevant question that one of the participants are really, we always say that they are not differentiate, we cannot differentiate body and mind. But how can we evaluate whether it's a physical dominant disease or a psychological dominant disease? I think for which we should go for the evaluation to the pariksha. Like the first of all, through the nidana, lakshana, and the different pariksha can be used. So if the you see that, for example, a patient comes to you saying that the person has a severe headache, okay, and this headache is because of his, whenever he has these arguments with his boss or whenever he has argument with his colleagues, he gets this headache. So they probably can feel that it is probably the argument that is causing a person to have a problem with the headache. So the manifestation is headache. Until unless you teach a person to change his interpersonal relationship and how to probably adjust, adopt and accept the various relationship within his office or his boss, this is not going to work. So this is how you can probably have the aspects. So it is basically either it is based on the nidanas, then you can always look for the lakshanas. See, many times what happens, the problem with this psychological, especially, see, many times in terms of the physical disease, there is no problem because many times whenever the patient comes with some physical disease, they directly come and say that I have fever, I have diarrhea, I have vomiting, etc. So I think the physical complaints are generally straightforward because the patient also understands that there is some physical illnesses. Always the challenge that we always face as a clinician is identifying the psychological involvement, because neither the patient understands that there is some psychological involvement, and more than that, there are so much of a social stigma associated with the psychological problem that people do not want to label them as psychologically ill. Just as they are easily able to accept the physical disease, still we are not in a scenario that people easily accept that he has some psychological illness like a depression, anxiety, or schizophrenia, bipolar disorders. It is still it's not in the verge. Though the statistics says that 1 in every 4 person has some psychological involvement. There are more than 30 million people suffering with psychiatric disorders. More than 20 million people suffering with addictions. 1 in every 40 seconds commit suicide. So this is a huge number when it comes to practice. But because of its atypical presentation, probably if we can make more awareness that it is okay, just as the body can have a problem, people will always say that those people who have psychological disorders, they just are trying to act that they have some psychological problems. People say, though you have, there is so much of air inside the atmosphere, why you are having difficulty in breathing? Can't you breathe? So though there are so much of help from your sides, can't you take support and be away from depression? See, just as though there are so much of air outside and still you have that problem and difficulty in breathing. Similarly, though there are so much support inside or outside the system of the society, still sometimes you could feel lonely and you could feel depressed. It is definitely okay that you have some psychological problems. Until unless either you manage by yourself or somebody from the family, or still if it is a minor or major problem, always you can take the help of a disease. Probably darshana, sparshana, and the prashna is especially understanding in terms of the nidana and the lakshana, and probably trying to develop a good rapport with the patient, then you could always have the link. See, and again, there could be some known factors and unknown factors, which probably we'll try to discuss sometimes, because sometimes it is not easily known what exactly could be the cause, where exactly, then again, a further probing need to be done. But otherwise, it is based on the cause factors and based on the clinical manifestation that you can make a judgment which dominates. And sometimes both could be equally dominating each other, then you need to address both.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for giving us a very clear-cut idea regarding the differentiation and the way of discerning between the physical disease as well as the mental disease. Now, before going to the next portion, that is about the regarding the positive swastika, I would like to raise some questions regarding and the role of the concept of papa and punya and the acharas, the rituals, the cultural beliefs and all those things in the making and breaking of these diseases generally. Sir, hello.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Maybe you can start.
Okay. In Ayurveda, there are descriptions about chidra. Chidram papa kriyarambha paga nishtasya karmana. There are some vulnerable situations and about prajnaparatha, some papa karma, which leads to diseases. And by experience, we can see that these type of acts or actions or verse leads to some guilty feeling. And many of our patients, they used to say that they have done some, or these symptoms started from asymmetry. They have found something, or they were frightened from asymmetry, or or near a temple, like that. That type of situations, or if they see something unusual near a cemetery or near a temple, they are feeling afraid. And many of the this type of the starting of the disease will be in such situations, because there are some concepts. These places are, there will be some non-living things, something something beyond our beliefs, or something beyond our life. It's there. And if a person has a belief like that, these type of people only become frightened in these situations. Or if a person is or have no such belief, they are not thinking about this type of papa karma or this type of vulnerable situations. They are aware about their mind, and they are aware about their situation. And many of the people many of the persons with Hina Sattva, they are thinking about their papa karma or their acts, and they are always thinking about that, and this guilty feeling is with them always, and this leads to mental disorders. One lady was there. She was telling that she entered into temple while going for a tour with her friends. She entered into the temple when she was menstruation, in her menstrual period, and her friends told that it's a papa karma, and the God will blame you, God will curse you, like that her friends told. And she thought that she has done a big sin, and she was always thinking about that, and for every whatever she is doing, she is thinking that she has done a papa karma. And this guilty feeling made her depressed. Not the act she has done made her depressed, or the feeling of this guilty, or the feeling of this guilt made her depressed. And if a person is with good sattvabala, the person will think that it's not a papa, I have done the proper thing, and the chance of mental disease or chance of depression is less in such situations. But if a person is with papa, with Hina Sattvata, they are always thinking about their papa karma. And I believe that the papa karma is not causing the disease. The feeling of guilt is making the disease, I think.
Yeah, I think I truly agree with madam that probably it has to do with more of the response or the perception about the papa karma rather than actual papa karma. See, as you mentioned that all the types of diseases are characterized by ruja. ruk or raga is a main feature of all the type of diseases. So maybe the physical disease or the mental disorders are characterized by the pain. Like even shalya also, no? Like it is manas sharira badhakarani shalyani. It is the pain or the we are talking about. And that is why, and even the it is the upadha or the attachment with the different substance that a person develops this ignorance, and that is how it develops develops as a diseases. Like even in the Bhagavad Gita also, where they mentions that dhyayate visham pumsan sangastit upajayate sangha sanjayate kamaha kamat krodha bhavati sammoha, isn't it? So the whole of the journey starts with the actual attachment. And human beings, we are always having this emotional attachment. And that is how we are always grown or made with different aspects of, suppose if you do some mistakes, the Rakshasa will come or he will punish you. So we always have these emotions. So that is why whenever we have, we always feel that whenever we make some mistakes, we are not eligible for the moksha. And that is why the whole of this achara rasanas are based with the concept that you can attain the salvation or liberation only when you are having the kshaya of rajas and tamas and all the karmas that you have done, which are to be devoid of. Okay. So that's the reason why if we can understand that you should have some social norms, and that is why we have this code of conducts. Maybe the personal code of conducts or the social code of conducts are the probably the compartment to say that this is what you are supposed to do whenever you are in the community or the society. You cannot go beyond that. And because always the rules are very, very important to see that a person is always, like, for example, there are traffic rules to prevent the accidents. Similarly, there are some rules in the life so that you do not come across various types of physical and mental disorders. But many times what happens, a person do not realize that he is doing some of papa karmas. Like for example, many of the thieves or terrorists, etc., if they can realize that they're doing wrong, no one is definitely going to do such commitments, because they have this ignorance. We always are bounded with a lot of ignorance of the life. We are not totally conscious about the life. So because of that, the reason, until unless we are shattered out of this, that is what is called as prasanna buddhi or tattva jnana. Okay. Until unless you have this tattva jnana, that you have a clear insight of what is right and wrong, you do not have this problem. So many of the problems in case of the papa karma are because many times you do not realize it. And if at all you realize it, you find difficult to come out of that. Okay. So that's the reason why always, like, for example, I'll just give one simple example that we had in our hospital 2 days back. I was in my rounds in the evening, and I realized that one of the patient of alcoholic patients has consumed alcohol, and he was talking to me. So I just told them, I think you have consumed alcohol, and this is not right that you're inside the hospital and you have consumed alcohol and you are there. Then he said, no, promise the doctor, I have not consumed alcohol. I swear that I have not consumed alcohol. Are you sure you're in the hospital of a Manjunatha Swami hospital? And I think you are telling a lie. No, I'm not telling lie. I'm really telling real that I have not consumed. Okay, if you are not consumed, that's fine, but I feel that you have consumed that, but take care of your health. And I came back. When I was there in the evening, my clinic at 8 o'clock, and he called me saying that I'm really extremely sorry that I have told lie with you. Now I realized that I have done a real mistakes. I in fact had consumed alcohol. And in fact, he called me 3-4 times in the midnight also. So I'm still feeling that guilt that I told wrong with you. So that is why sometimes, it is all about the realization that we should think of. And this is the ultimate cause for the liberalization. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Before going to the aspects of pathology and the management of the diseases, one final question regarding the swastha. See, we have elaborate discussions or descriptions regarding the sadvrata. And at this point, is it right to say that we have not yet realized or understood the real crux of sadvrata in the real sense of Ayurveda?
Many times what happens is see, these are the understand that Ayurveda is much beyond a medical science. Okay, it always tells us to live a happy living. Maybe it's a art of happy living is what we get in Ayurveda. And if you can take each one of them, see what happens is it sometimes we feel that many of these concepts are very philosophical, or it is more of a theoretical concepts. See, until unless we bring this philosophical basic concepts or the fundamental concepts into practice and see how it has its importance in the presentation, I think it can make a great difference. See, we have so much link as Madam was telling in Agri Aushadhis, like Sankalpo, Rishyanam, or it is the Somanasya Garbhadharananam. We always feel that there's a lot of role of this, the mental makeup, which can really differentiate between the, because it is not just the Ritu Kshetra Ambu Bija. It is much beyond that a person has this progeny, right? So that is why if we can make up all these aspects and then tell the importance that this is what is the importance of like the social code of conduct, the mental code of conduct, the rituals code of conduct, like how we should behave in the family, how we should be there in the organization, how you should be there in different outdoor events. Probably this is very, very important. It is just probably a guidelines for the self, you know? Because until unless you highlight its importance and given to the common man, see, any principles or concepts or science will always gain popularity when it has importance or when it comes to the practice of a common man. So probably we should try to get up, and it's a time that we need to create more awareness among the people about the science. And also, see, it is not only about the people, common people. I think as we, as preachers, teachers, practitioners, researchers of Ayurveda, we also have an equal role that we should start initially practicing the thing that we are preaching and see that, yes, this is what is the importance of the practicing, and this is what we have gained as a practice. And then we have become more authoritative probably to preach or probably give more awareness among the people. No? Like suppose I smoke and I tell patients not to smoke, probably they will not accept it. Probably I take the responsibility that I should not smoke, and then I have that responsibility, or I have that authority to tell that you should not smoke. So probably as Ayurvedic students and teachers, we should start implementing the fundamentals of sadhruta. And then probably it's a time that we can give them in a format that it could be accepted by the common man. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for this enlightening explanation. And now, with your permission, sir and madam, we shall move over to the next portion, that is regarding the pathogenesis and symptomatology. And being a person who was very much involved in the management of this stress-related disorders related to COVID, the recent COVID spread in Malappuram. Madam, could you please share some of your thoughts regarding the role of the understanding of body-mind complex in the management of preventive role, as well as the preventive role basically in the pandemic situations and associated panic and all those things. What has been your experience so far? Could you please share some of it to us?
In the preventive role, then first, jnana, vijnana, dhairya, smriti, samadhi. Jnana is the important thing. Because always in the first or in the starting of this epidemic or COVID, people were unaware about that. What is COVID and for what this lockdown, everything, people are not aware about that. If proper jnanam, if proper awareness is there, then the fear or anxiety will be less. And first, all of them were anxious about what is happening. They don't know what is happening. And then after some time or after day, after some days, then only they could understand or what is the disease or what is happening and what will happen if this persists like that. Then only if they are properly aware about the disease or about the condition, and if they can take proper measure to overcome them, then only they'll be satisfied or their anxieties will be over. But because in the first situation always, and the other thing, first everywhere will be everyone were anxious about the situation, and the next thing is the circumstances, because many of them lost their job and many of them didn't get proper income. Because of that, the other type of anxiety or people were depressed according to the situation. And then there were many cases of depression, mainly depression, anxiety, sleep disorder, these type of problems were there because of this COVID situation. And these two were the main factors. First were the awareness or unawareness of this situation, and because of their social conditions of or the loss of money like that. And then it's very difficult to overcome. But first we have to understand what how we can overcome this situation. And if a person has some financial problem, then it's not an easy way how to overcome and to educate them how can they overcome the disease. That's a problem. But even with proper financial support, then also many of the people had some psychological issues, because they were moving in a regular way, that is going to the office and then doing some works in the morning. They were working in a proper timetable, and all of them were disturbed in this situation, and they were sitting home alone, and they have nothing to do like that. And because of this situation also, people became very stressed, and their proper work routine has some problem. So then also they were very stressed, and this type of depression, anxiety, this type of problems were there. And one another problem was addiction. This addiction became more. And one day, they didn't get this alcohol. The bars were closed, and then the withdrawal symptoms were there. Then the addiction case or the addiction cases were the problems of addiction were more in that type of situation, and like that, many psychological issues we have faced in this pandemic season, in this situation. And this type of the quarantine issues, they were alone in a house, and nobody were the to talk. Then they were isolated, and then also this cases of depressions were more, and suicidal tendencies were more. And we have introduced campaign like Jeeva Amritam, that is to how to control or how to identify the depression and how to overcome the suicidal tendencies like that. We have introduced a campaign. There are lots of issues during this pandemic we are facing. Doctor,
thank you, madam. Thank you for sharing your experience. Sir Suhas, sir, the one of the most important aspects in the diagnosis or in the prognostic evaluation is the understanding of the sattva vishesha of the patient. And we have learned of, we have heard of this guru vyadhida, laghu vyadhida, and such situations. And how do we differentiate, or how do we implement these concepts in the real practice?
Yeah, I think, again, this is a very important and very relevant question that one of the participants has asked, because we always give importance for the sattva in terms of the diagnosis, management, and it is a very important factor. So before before I could tell how to assess them, let me just give a very short applied aspects why it is important. See, as you all know that most of the diseases, like for example, if you go to the samprapti of Unmada, it starts with tair alpa sattvasya mala apradushtaha. See, what happens is those people who are having alpa sattva, they are more prone to suffer with various types of disorders, especially the psychiatric disorders. And because you need a lot of energy, or you need to put a lot of efforts in convincing the patients for treatment, in making the patients saying that there is importance of panchakarma, or suppose you want to tell them about different psychotherapies or different sattvajaya techniques. So you need to put a lot of energy. Okay. So that is why it is very, very important. But then also, even the selection of the treatment or the selection of the therapies are quite challenging when it comes to alpa sattva people. Whereas in case of the pravara sattva people, they're more motivated, and it becomes very easy for you to motivate them for some form of activities, diet, lifestyle modifications. It's quite easy. Now, the basic question comes is like, how do you assess them? Okay. See, there are many, you get the basic reference that you get about Sattva Pariksha is from Charaka Vimanasthana, 8th chapter. And also you get in Shushruta Samhita, Sutra Sthana, 35th chapter. So especially in Charaka and Shushruta, these are two important references that you get. From Charaka Vimana 8th chapter and Shushruta Sutra Sthana 35th chapter. So the basic question that you can always ask is how a person is motivated for a situation. You can give an example, like you can ask the patient to narrate any of the stressful event and ask the patients how he or she responded to this event. If a person is self-motivated, then you feel that a person is having pravara sattva. If a person gets motivated by others, like seeing others, like for example, there is a small, maybe 1 meter pit, which is there in front of us. And there are three people who are there. And there is the first person who feels that, okay, probably this is 1 feet and I have that strength and capacity to cross this and to jump this. And he takes this with all the care, he jumps this pit. And then he feels that, yes, I can do that. Okay. So probably those people who get initiated randomly by themselves, these are the qualities of a pravara sattva. Okay. The first guy has jumped and I think I can also do that. If he can jump, I can also do that. And the next person also, by seeing the other person, he tries to jump it. Probably this is a quality of a madhyama sattva. Whereas the third person is neither motivated by seeing others, not he is self-motivated. Oh, no. I think I cannot jump. I will fall over the pit. I do not have strength. Well, this is what is the examples. So it is basically based on, as see, there are two things, like as mentioned in Shushruta Sutra Sthana, that is, it is by vyasana and abhyudaya, by the positive and the negative events, or the happy and the sad events, that you can always make a guess how a person was. Like this is more of a pre-morbid assessment before a person is diseased. Because what happens, this is not the sattva that we are talking about at present status. Because of the disease, it could have an impact. So all this except vikriti in the Dashavidha Pariksha, this has to be assessed in the pre-morbid status before a person was apparently healthy. So this is and then you can draw a near normal for that particular person. And then you can assess how he has deviated from his normal. See, there's nothing called as normal in psychiatry or this sattva pariksha. It is a self-normal that you define and then differentiate this. And that is what is important. So I think the basic question would be like how a person is motivated to a stressful situation can be a very important factor. And I think Parvati madam can definitely throw some light on that, because her post-graduation study was on this Sattva Pariksha, and she tried to associate this Sattva Pariksha with astrology. And again, there's one more question in this particular chat box, which I could see. Like, sometimes how could we take up the unexplained symptoms? And such unexplained symptoms, I think such allied sciences like astrology can definitely play a major role in its assessment. And there are some other techniques, like there's something called as biofeedbacks and heart rate variabilities. I think this is a very, very important techniques which can use in unexplained techniques. But I think we'd like to hear from Parvati madam on the role of astrology and the concept of Sattva Pariksha. Over to you, madam.
In astrology, there are some particular positions of graha where they can assess the mental stamina of a person. And I have compared this with a questionnaire, Sattva Bala questionnaire. And we could see that more than 70% of the participants, we could see similar results in the astrology and in through the questionnaire. And for mental disorder, I think the chance of mental disorder is there for pravarasattva also. If the exposure for stress is for a long time, if stress is severe and it's for a long time, the chance of mental disorder is there, but not as a hinasattva person, if a person is exposed to more severe stress. But it's easy to cure, because we can the sattva vijaya will be more, we can do more easily for a person with more sattva bala, and they can understand the situation very easily. And the treatment, in the treatment aspect, it's more easy to treat the person with proper sattva bala. And in the astrological aspect, we just check whether we just compare the positions of this the persons of with whether the person is of pravara, madhya or hina. And in astrology, that was just a comparison. And we can assess the sattva bala with astrology also. In my in the study, we could assess that. But in the treatment aspect, we can assess in the premorbid personality, we can assess that whether the person was of pravara sattva or hina sattva, the sattva bala of the person. And I think almost more than 90% of the patients with psychological issues will be of hina sattva. And we can see that their parents also, in a maternal or paternal way, they also will be of hina sattva. And the chance of hina sattva or the chance of the sattva bala will be inherited. Even though the parents have no mental disorder, it is there is no genetic factor is there. We can see that one of the parents, in the maternal or paternal way, they will be of hina sattva. And for a hina sattva patients, more than the patient, their family will be very anxious. We can see with their conversation also that they will be of hina sattva, and it's very difficult to convince the parents too. More than the patient, it's very difficult to convince the parents. And the sattva bala has a very, very important role in the causation of the disease, in the treatment and the preventive level.
Thank you, madam. Thank you. Now I'll come. One of the question that has been raised is we have the sharira doshas, the vada pitta kapas are there, and then we have the mano doshas, that is the rajas and tamas. And how these things are integrated or comprehended in the diagnosis, prognosis, and the design of the management, or is it that it is predominantly only the sharira doshas that are considered in the management of such diseases?
Manasika doshas are also, manasika doshas also plays important role in person's disease. And we are treating for the body, and we are treating the body, and the when we are doing the shodhana karma the panchakarma, other therapies, we are pacifying the doshas. They in turn pacify the manasa dosha also, because of this tathase shuddha dehase prasadun labhate mana. We are controlling the pitta and other doshas by virechana vamana and all other treatments. Then in turn we are controlling the manasika doshas, and after purifying the body of after the shodhana procedure, we can do the sattva vijaya chikitsa. And at the time of or just after the type admission, for most of the patients we cannot do this sattva vijaya therapy, and we cannot do anything for the manasika doshas, because this counseling and other sattva vijaya process will not act properly at that time, because the patient will not be with proper insight, and they cannot understand what we are saying. And after a proper shodhana procedure, they will be in such a situation that they can accept what we are saying after the body purification and after the shodhana procedure. And then after getting the manaprasada, they can understand what they are telling. And at that time, this what yoga therapy or the sattva vijaya procedure, psychotherapy, everything can work. And this in turn controls their manasika dosha. They can control their rajas and tamas, and they can understand what their situation is. Then this treatment will be, the other procedures will be effective.
Thank you, madam.
Yeah, I think, basically it's all about like which are the doshas which need to be focused on. Like, if it is more of a stula sharira, stula bhaga or stula sharira, then probably we focus more on the sharika doshas. But if it is a sukshma bhaga or the manasika bhavas which are involved, then we have to focus on the manasika. For example, like it all depends upon the like the involvement. Like if it is you want to correct the sharika doshas, then the different types of yuktyopasha chikitsa, shodhana, shamana are be more beneficial. But if you want to correct the rajas and tamas, they are all the sukshma bhavas, and for which you can use maybe different. You can use the medicines or the diet prescription. But more than that, probably the various steps of the sattvaja chikitsa will be playing a major role, like jnana, vijnana, dhairya, smriti, samadhi, or dhidhairya, atmadhi, vijnanam, divargasya, anveshanam, tadvidya, seva. So they will have a major role in the manifestation, as well as the in case of the causation of the various types of diseases. See, and all of them are always interrelated. The sharika doshas as well as the manasika doshas are also interrelated, and they're also related with the panchamahabhutas. So basically, we always say that the vata is related with rajas, pitta is related with sattva, and the kapha dosha is related with the tama dosha. It is not exclusive, like it is not that it's only 1:1, but always it's a dominance. Again, it is based on the panchamahabhutic dominance of the is important. Okay, so it's all where we want to focus, whether you need the medicines, therapies focusing on the body, or you want some form of psychotherapies focusing on the mind. So that is the relevance or importance of the sharika doshas and the manasika doshas. See, as you get the reference in Charaka, Sutrasthana, first chapter, where after he mentions the sharika dosha and dosha, he mentions about the treatment. Where Charaka says that it is Shamyati Aushadam Purvam Daiva Yukti Pashrayehi Manaso Jnana Vijnanam Dhairya Smriti Samadhibhi. For the management of Prashamyati Purva, here Pura refers to the sharika doshas. For sharika doshas, prashamatya can be done with the help of yuktyapashra and daivapashra chikitsa. And for the treatment of the manasika doshas, you have to go with di dhairya atmadi vijnanam mano dosha ashadam param or jnana vijnanam dhairya smriti samadhibhi. And you have to differentiate where exactly do you use the daivapashra and yuktyapashra. It is based on whether you are able to identify the doshas, dhatus, and agni involvement is present you are able to identify specific doshas, the exact, the nidanas you are able to assess, you can definitely use Yuktya Parsha Chikitsa. When the nidanas are not been elicited, when you are not able to understand the involvement of the doshas, that is where you can use different Vyadhi Pratyanika Chikitsa in the form of Daivaya Parsha Chikitsa. So that is a basic difference between the application of the, when the cause is clearly known, when it undergoes a set parameters based on the dosha, agni, etc., use Yuktya Parsha. When the causes are unknown, Daivam iti adrishtam, when you are not able to exactly assess the cause, then that's the time when you can use the Vyadhi Pratyanika Chikitsa in the form of Daivaya Parsha Chikitsa. And many of them, they, it works on the basis of the faith, and it corrects the different levels, like even treating the Papa Karma, treating the Adharma, all this, like there is Prayashchitta, Homa, Niyama, all these are based for the tranquilizing your basic Dharma and the Papa Karmas. And that is where it is important that you should understand whether you are able to identify the exact cause, or whether there the causes are unknown. And that is a basic difference between, and that is what is called as Vipashraya, is based on, okay, based on Yukti, based on Adrishta Karanas.
One more thing, sir. Then now also in this present era also, people are thinking that mental disorders are because of some evil spirits or something. And their first choice of treatment is some spiritual healers. And they are telling that, they will not tell that it's purely a disease, you have to do treatment. Some astrologers or something, they will tell that there is something inside their body, or there is some gara, or in Malayalam, they are saying, we are saying that kaivisham. That's gara, gara inside their body. And patients are coming to us requesting that we have to expel it out. There is some toxins inside their body, we have to expel it out. And after doing this Vamana, Vamana is very effective in Unmada. Unmada is very, Vamana is very effective, mainly in Kapha Unmada. But more than that, there is a psychological effect of Vamana. After doing Vamana, people are thinking that their this toxic materials inside their body has come out, and they are getting a psychological effect also. And if a person is not thinking like that, this Vamana has a therapeutic effect, that's the, and Vamana will be effective in Unmada. But moreover that, this type of Deva Vyapashraya Chikilsa will be effective in persons who are believing in God or this spiritual things. Otherwise, and that type of people are very less. I think less than 10% of the people are thinking like that. More people are thinking about this type of spiritual things, and they are requesting us to do, or they are requesting us this type of Vamana or other type of treatment, and then spiritual therapies. And these are based on their concepts or their beliefs.
Definitely, ma'am. I think this is really true. See, because especially when it comes to the psychiatric conditions, you understand that more than the problem, it is the patient's perception about the problem which will play a major role. Like what patient thinks is the problem. The patient will always think that whenever only I'm going to that particular place, then only I'll hear this sound. There is someone waiting for me. There is someone seeing me. Because see, you can think that patient is very illogical, and you can give your own explanation. But until unless patient, you change the patient's perception, what patient is thinking, then only it will make the changes. See, if you go to the modern research also, there is a concept called as meaning response. It is called as meaning response. Meaning response is a concept with what intention patient is taking the treatment. With what faith the patient is taking the treatment. See, that's why many times they say, no, even a placebo also sometimes works in many of the diseases, because the patient has that faith with which the patient takes the treatment. And if the patient feels that, yes, he is a doctor or he is a healer who can heal me. And even if you go to a spiritual healer, or if you go to witchcraft also, if a patient feels that he can heal me, and he gives some prasada, or he gives some prasada also, even he gives a water also, the patient feels that as I'm perfectly fine. So it is not just the treatment, but it is with what intention and or what perception patient takes a treatment, what faith patient takes a treatment, that plays a very, very major role in the treatment of mental disorders. I totally agree with what madam has supported.
Yeah, one of our patient order, his father wanted, his father is well, he is not getting good sleep. And he wanted a water from a spiritual healer, Thangal. He wanted water from there. And the son has no such beliefs. And he went to the shop and bought some mineral water and packed in a good another bottle. And he gave it to his father. And after taking this water, his father slept very well. And this only a belief. And this because of this, the father thought that it's from this spiritual healer or Thangal. And it was only a mineral water. And if a person has such a belief, then this works properly.
Madam, thank you. Madam, thank you, sir. And now I think it is time to seek some of the queries from the participants of the session. And I request some of the members of this assembly to come up with some of the questions which they have so that our panelists can give some satisfactory explanations and satisfy our queries. Thank you. Hello.
I think Sethuraj, there are some questions in the chat box. Before you can also pick those questions before anybody could start asking the questions. Yeah, Manavasrutas. See, basically, as you all know, that all the dhatus are very much related to Manavasrutas or Manasika Doshas. I think the Rasavasrutas plays a very, very important role. Because as you all know, that the Srotomula of Rasavasrutas is Hridaya, and it's also the seat, the Manas, the Hridaya is also the seat of the Manas and Buddhi also. So that is why it is very much related. And if you go to the Charaka Vimanasthane Sroto Vimana chapter, and if you look to the Sroto Dushti Karanas, especially the Rasava Sroto Dushti Karanas, it is mentioned that it is Ati Chintana is one of the main causes for Rasava Sroto Dushti. And this is also we find that many times the basic digestion, metabolism, nourishment, nutrition is totally hampered whenever a person is under stress or in case of emotional disturbances. So the most important dhatus, which is related with the Manavasrutas is Rasa, then followed by Majja.
One question is, at what point we can differentiate Manodosha and Manoroga? I think Manodosha is a Prakriti. And then if a person is having a sudden change in the personality, and if it is disturbing the person or others, if it is getting a loss of freedom to that person or others, and if it is persisting for a long time, other than his prakriti, it has some precipitating factors, and it is starting from a point, and it is persisting for a long time. It's not a sudden change in the personality, or it's a sudden response to an event. If it is not a sudden response to an event, then it will be a roga. Otherwise, it will be a dosha or prakriti, or the personality of that, mental personality of that person. If it has some precipitating factors, and it is not a sudden response to a particular event, and it is persisting, then we can assess that there are some disease, or there is a disease in that person, and then a consultation is needed. And if it is causing loss of freedom to that person or others. If it is a depression that type of, if the person is with insight and it is a depression, it is causing discomfort to that person. And if it is a mania, the person is the deceased person, the patient will tell that I am okay, and the others will suffer with that disease. So treatment is needed.
There's one more question by Dr. Induleka, who asks how to maintain the dosha satmya in mental health. If you want to be mentally happy, or if you want to be mentally relaxed, mentally maintain your mental health or mental well-being, probably one of the best sutra that I will mention is Nityam Hita Ahara Vihara Sevi Samikshakari Visheshu Asaktaha Dataha Samaha Satyaparaha Shamavan Aptopa Sevicha Bhavanti Aroga. See, the same shloka also repeats in Charaka Sharanasthana, second chapter, where he says only the difference is, instead of Nityam Hita Ahara Vihara Sevi, he has used the word Naro Ahara Vihara Sevi. So the regular uses of a good diet is very, very important. Taking a very wholesome, balanced diet is very, very important. Involving in physical activities, at least 20 minutes of exercises 5 days a week is very, very important. And also being more analytical of what is right, what is wrong. And more than that, if we can be emotionally detached with the worldly problems and be involved in kindness, charity, and also have that habit of forgiving the people, not keeping a lot of things in your mind, no? Because whatever people has done will always reflect back through their karmas. But you should always take the best part of everybody's interaction and the communication with your routine life. So that's the reason why it is more of a well-being that you can always maintain by being and engaged in some charity, like helping the kids, old age, disabled. And that gives you a lot of satisfaction, and not only for the people who take this benefit, but also those who are giving this help. So this is what you can always do. So, like, most importantly, be happy with what you are having, and be satisfied, and communicate with the people. And the most important thing is enjoy what you're doing. Like, the best way of satisfaction is do what really enjoys, makes you enjoyment, and love your work, love your family, and share in case of any crisis, difficulties, share with your friends, family members, have a good social connectivity. This really helps in maintaining good mental health.
Sir, one other question that has been raised is the role of rituals and these cultural practices in the sustenance of mental health.
See, definitely. See, what happens is there are, I think as Parvati Madam was telling, no, I think more than people coming to our hospital or our consultation, people generally have their own practices which are there. And and it is not that they do not help them, no. And many people, like, when they come and they tell that I have been doing this practices, whether I can do that. See, until unless it is not, people are not fooling you or people are not misleading you, definitely all these practices are definitely acceptable. And if it gives you some remedies or some solace, definitely you can continue doing all those rituals which a person is practicing. See, it's, as I said, no, it is all about the intention of the patients. Like, what patient thinks about that particular practice is more important than the actual practice. So it's more of a perception about, or the belief about, different practices. Because only until I have, like, suppose I have a faith in a particular God, then only, and I go to that particular temple or God, then definitely it helps me. But if I do not have that faith, and I go for the force of my parents or my children, and I go and it doesn't really works, or it really does not help. That is why, no, the self motivation is very, very important, because we get patients who are addictions and who come to the for the force of their family members, and we see that such people, the success rate is very, very poor. But if the patient is self-motivated and comes for quitting the alcohol or any of the drugs like cannabis or opioids or any of the illicit drugs, their response or their success rate is much, much higher as compared with those people who do not have this. So definitely if the patient has various practices and if the patient finds that he gets relief and if it is not causing financial or personal trouble, I think he can definitely do that. Because there are a lot of people who exploit such thinking and practices. Because that's the reason why you need to find some genuine guide for such spiritual or healing practices. Because you know that there are a lot of people who can definitely misuse such thoughts and practices.
And if a patient has a minor depression and the person is a believer, then I used to tell them to chant Lalita Sahasranama. If the person is a Hindu and if he is a believer, then only. We can say to chant Lalita Sahasranama, then only they are telling that they are getting good relief. That's a depends upon their beliefs.
Thank you, madam. Thank you, sir. We are approaching our permitted time for today, and I think there is chance for one final discussion. And the one question that was raised was the concept of Papa seems to change over time and place. And so, is there any standard protocol for a definition of a Papa? This was one of the questions.
No, in the concept of graha also, we cannot say that this type of pishacha graha, rakshasa graha, this type of concepts are there now in this period also. Bhudasya rupa prakriti bhasha gati, like that one person is acting to that particular person or to the particular rakshasa or what pishacha, whatever it may be. If a person has a guilty feeling and it is they are expressing this as an escapism, this type of different personalities comes. Nowadays, people are not aware about this or they are not familiar with this Rakshasa and Pishacha. They are familiar with the robot and computer. Then if a person has this type of psychological stress and this type of dissociative characters, they are acting like a robot or something else like that. But the concept of Papa and this type of what personalities are nowadays, it is not there. And this Guru Ninda like that, now we are not thinking that as a Papa. And it's to redefine what is Papa.
That is why we always see there is a separate branch of Ayurveda called as Bhuta Vidya and Graha Chikitsa, which is most oftenly misunderstood and misinterpreted. I think the most misunderstood branch of Ashtanga Ayurveda or least understood is Bhuta Vidya. And the reason is, there are plenty of reasons why there is this misunderstanding of this particular branch. Starting from the word itself, there is a lot of misnomer. People think that it is a branch of demonology, it is a branch of a ghost, it is a branch of witchcraft. I think there was a huge discussion in the late part of 2019 when universities declared that they are going to run a course in Bhuta Vidya. And they announced this on 24th of December 2019. And 26th of December 2019, BBC released news saying that one of the top universities of India is going to teach doctors about ghost science. So this was a heading. If you open to the news on BBC of 26th December 2019, Bhuta Vidya, the science of ghost, is to be taught to the doctors. See, there are a lot of misunderstanding among the common man. Not only common man, probably, first of all, we have to clear this understanding among the doctors itself or among the Ayurvedic fraternity. What exactly is this branch? See, if a branch of Ayurveda is being given a status of Ashtanga, it should have some relevance in the basic concepts of Ayurveda. It should be in tune with the basic concepts of Ayurveda. Otherwise, definitely, it wouldn't have been a part of Ashtanga Ayurveda. See, Ashtanga Ayurveda is divided based on the age, based on the causative factors, based on the preventive or promotive aspects, or based on the parts involved like Shalakya Tantra, etc. But see, when you are able to identify the exact cause of a disease in terms of the Sharika Rogas or the in terms of the Mansika Doshas, you can always put under the category of Kaya Chikitsa. But when you are not able to understand the exact cause, and when there are the external factors which is influencing the different aspects of... Hello?
You're audible, sir. Please go ahead, sir.
Yeah, and if you're able to identify the exact cause, if you can call this Bhuta Vidya as the mind-body complex, idiopathic mind-body complex.
Hello, sir. Hello.
That's the problem.
I think Suhasar is having some network issue, I think.
Okay, sir.
So Parvati madam can continue.
Buddha Vidya, that the term itself is misunderstood by I think almost all the people, and this is an escapism of mind. Then from severe stress, that's a dissociative personality, that's a different type of personality they are performing to escape from their stress or escape from their their mind. They are doing this type of different personalities. Nowadays, it's saying as dissociative identity disorder, and many of the symptoms we cannot explain how they are expressing these type of symptoms. But after analyzing their personality or analyzing their stress factors, precipitating factors, we can see that it's a type of escapism from their stress or showing this type of dissociative characters. But this the name itself, I think the name Bhuta Vidya, they are thinking that that's a demonology. But in almost we have assessed the symptoms of mental disorders of each patient coming to our hospital. And in almost all disorders, we can see some symptoms of that is Graha Badha, Bhuta Graha, along with other psychological symptoms. We have assessed all the symptoms described in Bhuta Graha and Unmada, and we are comparing this with the present symptoms of the patient. And then we can see that some of the Graha symptoms we can see in almost all the patients, and some type of these stressful situations will be there. Then, but we are doing treatment in an institution level. We are doing treatment in a mainly in the Yukti Kepashraya manner. And along with that, or after the treatment, they can do Satvabjaya to improve their mental health. And so I was telling that it is misunderstood like demonology, like that. Sir Kane. Yes, sir, we'll get.
Yeah, I think Madam has continued and she has given the overview. See, basically, as we were discussing, no, it has it involves all those factors which we are not able to understand at a very gross level, and which do not follow a pattern of the Sharika aspects of a disease. And all, like for example, when you classify the dukkhas, like we have the Adhyatmika, Adi Bhautika, and Adi Daivika. And in this aspects of the Adi Daivika aspects of the disease, it has to be done. We have to take the perspective of this, the causative factors of the doshas or the Bhuta and the Grahas, and then the various aspects of the diseases. And that is where the various types of the Daivapash Chikitsa has a major role to play in the management of the Bhuta Vidyas, like even japa, tapa, homa, niyama, prayaschitta, pranipata, gamana, all this plays a major role in the management as well as in the treatment of various types of, it involves various types of psychosomatic and somatic disorders. Like, for example, if we take the help of Harita Samhita also, there are 10 types of the manifestations. And in these 10 types, like each one of you, you can relate with the different types of the aspects. Okay. And if we can probably go into the basic concepts, probably our understanding becomes much, much better with Bhuta Vidya. Okay. Thank you.
It has been a very fruitful and enlightening discussion so far, and several uncleared areas and confusing areas have been cleared so far, and I think it has been the experience of all the participants here also. And now it's the time to seek the concluding comment from both of the panelists, and first of all I invite Parvati ma'am to present her concluding comments regarding this conversation. Hello.
The understanding of this mind-body relationship will help for a better approach in treatment, which leads to a better result in treatment, to provide better quality of life and to control recurrence of disease. And we have to get a good rapport with the patient, then only we can analyze the psychological issues along with the physical problem. Even if it is a pure physical problem, then also there will be some psychological issues because of the disease. If we can correct these psychological issues, then only we will get a proper improvement in their disease, or proper cure of the disease. So along with the physical conditions, we can assess, we have to assess the psychological issues, and we have to correct the psychological issues, and we have to give proper psychological support. Then only we can get a better result in the treatment, and it will help to control the recurrence of disease also. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for having made this evening a very enlightening one. Thank you very much. And now, finally, from Suha sir, your concluding comments regarding the topic for today.
At the outset, let me really appreciate the great effort taken by the Tirumal Park Foundation in bringing up a very, very relevant topic of what being the theme discussion today, on how the body and mind are related in health and disease. And as we had the very good responses and a good number of active participation by the audience and the senior faculties sharing their experiences, definitely, I think if we can have this understanding that the body and mind are not a separate compartmental determination or description, they always go hand in hand. It all depends upon the extent of involvement, which differentiates in naming as the body or and mind. But otherwise, they're always interrelated to one another, and they will have a major role to play in the diagnosis, management, and treatment. So we should always consider both body and mind whenever we are talking about the diagnosis, the etiopathogenesis, the symptomatology, and most importantly, in the treatment of such disorders. Because if we can give importance to both body and mind, I think our what we call it or call Ayurveda as a comprehensive or holistic will be able to achieve by focusing on the different aspects of the treatment. And not only that is what even Shushruta Sutrasthana mentioned, that there are four components of treatment: ahara, vihara, achara, and aushadhis. Aushadhi or medicines are just 1/4 of the treatment. Definitely, diet, lifestyle, and mental care or psychological support has a role in the management of all physical and mental disorders. So I am really humbled and grateful to the organizers for this wonderful opportunity. And I thank all the participants for their active involvement. Thank you.
Thank you,
Dr.
Sadhguru and Tirumal Park Foundation. Thank you all. Thank you for inviting me, Professor.
Thank you.
A great occasion.
Hello, sir.
Hello. Hello. Amra.
Am I audible? You're audible, Dr. Sethi.
Yes.
Yeah. So, the final point I would like to say is that from today's discussion, we could arrive at a consensus that there is the need for comprehending the body mind complex as a single unit rather than. There is definitely the need to differential understanding of the thing, but the whole thing has to be understood as a continuum, and it is only with this comprehensive understanding can we be successful in the real sense of the Ayurvedic practice. So, and with this few words, I transfer the responsibilities to Om Prakash for the conclusion of this session. Thank you.
Thank you. What to say, it was a really great session, and the topic before the Tadvidya Sambhasha itself, it was a very unique topic, and it was suggested by one of our colleagues saying that it's a need of hour, that the topic is a need of hour, as the world is going so much competitive, the humans are finding or inventing so much technology gadgets for facilitating their life, and it's getting complicated so much. So in such an era, it's very important to look at the life in the angle of mind as well. So sharirendriya sattvaatma samyogo hari jeevitam itsayasin charaka. So only Ayurvedis can view the human body in such a holistic approach. So that is very important nowadays, and I don't know whether how many of Ayurvedis are aware of this angle, and how many of them are using it in their day-to-day practice. It's very important, I think. Maybe as Suhas sir and Parvati madam said, many of the things are being considered outdated or like the demonistic. They are looking it in that angle. So we have to look it in a different angle. We have to renovate the things, because that idea, that concepts is not getting outdated. And I think it's more than being outdated, it's being very relevant nowadays. So we have to look at that. I think it is not easy to cover the whole topics of body mind relation just 1.5 or 2 hours. So there are a lot of things to be discussed. I think it's just a spark to be thinking on the topics, I think. And then today, we have discussed a lot of things. Adhishtana of as mind as an adhishtana. Sadvruta, Ajara Rasayana, Sattva Bala, importantly. That is really important topic to be pondered. Tattva Bodha, Swasthya, Achara, the role of Achara in our Sattvabala, or like that, mental disorders, Anugraha, Bhuta Vidya, lot of topics we have discussed. It was really a fruitful session. Thank you so much, Parvati Madam, Suhas sir, and our discussant, Sedra sir. A really wonderful session. We'll look ahead next Vidya Sambhasha with another topic the next second Sunday. So with that, I once again thank all the delegates, all the participants who are there in this session with us. We expect the same ahead also. So with that, I thank once again on a dot. Thank you.
Thank you very much.